everyone. My name is Rudy Fernandez, and I got selected to do this, to moderate this panel by the chair of the speakers committee. I happen to be my wife, Donna Fernandez. And a good excuse to wear my name here on my chest, that way I won't get too lost, like he was saying. So all the panel members need to put on their... The month of February, our meeting for February, we meet the first Friday of every month. In the February meeting, we tend to have a greater percentage of newbies. People who have interested in bees, maybe don't have bees at all. And so what we wanted to do was to have a panel discussion that discusses some of the fundamentals related to bees. Each of our panelists will introduce themselves, and they'll discuss how long they've been a beekeeper, how and where did they become beekeepers, and maybe something that somebody would have told them something in the beginning that would have helped a great deal. So yeah, this is something that beekeeping is something that if, you have to do. There's no other way to learn it. It's, you can only learn so much from the book. So. Without further ado, let's just start with each of our panelists. Take a couple of minutes to introduce yourselves and follow this this process, and off we go. So Peter?
Yes, you do.
Hi, my name is Peter Shantos. I'm in the Boca Raton. I've been a beekeeper for about 4 years. I started because I had a hive that decided to occupy a little bird's nest that I made. And it was a 5-apartment bird's nest. So they decided to, you know, fill it, and I decided to wait until after the avocados and the mangoes and all the other flowering plants had bloomed, and before I opened it up. I went down to South Florida Bee Supplies and got some equipment. Gloria was very helpful. And I put them in the new hive, and they decided to flee. So I was bee-less. But my neighbor Tom said, you know, there's a guy, Al, and he has a special program, and you can get some bees from him. So with Al and Sierra, I credit myself to making them go into business, because they learned, why should they give this information for free when they can make money at it? So I did that, help them. One important thing that I wish I had learned is I probably should have bought a suit. I only bought a jacket. And they got me on the legs and the ankles, so then I got boots, and then I wore 2 pants, and then they got me on the arms, and I wore 2 shirts. So now I think I'm okay. I don't need the suit anymore.
My name is Sierra. I'm the owner of Sierra's Bees. I got my first beehive from Al when I lived in Boca in a big house with no yard, and I wanted to have a connection with something in nature and a connection to my food. So I got my first beehive from Al. That was 4 years ago. Last year I ran about 400 colonies as a commercial beekeeper, breeding queens, selling bees, teaching backyard beekeeping, and having a lot of fun. I've scaled down a little bit in keeping my own bees. I do a lot of private hive management. Al and I run Florida Backyard Beekeepers Association, where we offer classes, hands-on education workshops for backyard beekeeping. We donate our time to that. I still raise a few queens for backyard beekeepers, but I still love my bees and the connection that it gives me to the earth, to my food, to nature. And one thing I wish that I had known in the beginning was that bees really do know how to be bees. I probably knew that somewhere in the back of my mind, but I wasn't listening to it. Bees know how to be bees, so let bees be bees, and find a balance between checking your bees every day or every week like I did, and killing my first beehive, and letting your bees be bees.
Ready? this? On the day I was born, I got stung by a bee. Ever since that day, I've been acting kind of funny. I'm Sam Comfort. I run Anarchy Apiaries. I've been a commercial beekeeper for 14 years now, and I'm not even exaggerating. I've been raising queens and treatment-free for 12 of those 14 years. These days we run probably around 700 hives. It's me and Tucker Seville there in the back, and mostly we raise and sell queen bees and ship them around the country. And I guess when I got started, some good advice to me would have been to take it beezy. You know, bees come and go, money comes and goes, people come and go, it's all, you just gotta roll with it.
Really? I gotta follow that? There once was a girl from Nantucket. She used to keep bees, but then, no. My name is Al Salopek. Where did I start? I got into bees about 10 years ago because my neighbor had bees in the eaves of his house. I had just sold the last restaurant that I had. So I was in the restaurant industry all my life, and I retired from the restaurant industry. And without anything to do, he came to me and he said, "Hey, how can I get rid of these bees in the eave of my house?" And I said, "I don't know, but don't kill them, because I heard they're having problems." And he said, "What kind of problems are bees having?" I said, "I don't know, they're dying or something." And I was embarrassed that I didn't know what I was actually talking about. And so I said, "Well, we can Google and YouTube how to get rid of those bees." And that's what we did. And we went into the eave of his house and removed that first set of bees. And I was smitten by those bees, because I've always wanted to control 60,000 women and move them into a new location. And this is the only way I can do it. And so from that day forward, I started studying about bees and finding out why bees were actually having problems. And I found out that nobody really knew. And there was this little piece of information and this little piece of information and that little piece of information, but nobody was really putting everything together to come up with the answer. Well, during my research, I saw one statistic that interests me. It said that we have 50% less bees in the United States than we did 30 years ago. And then right below that, it said, we have 50% less commercial beekeepers in the United States than we did 30 years ago. And I was like, okay, I can't do anything about pesticides. I can't do anything about fungicides. I can't do anything about industrialized farming. I can't do anything about raising tens of thousands of queens and bastardizing the genetic population of bees. But I can influence the younger generation to become a beekeeper and try to increase the number of commercial beekeepers that we have. And obviously, if we increase the number of commercial beekeepers that we have, we will increase the number of bees that we have. And so I thought it was very simple. And so I said, well, the amount of knowledge that I have in my head for bees is about equivalent to a second or third grade level. So I will start a nonprofit organization to teach second and third graders how to keep bees, or at least introduce them to beekeeping, and that it's an option. So I started a nonprofit called Bee Understanding, and along with that, I started doing removals of bees from unwanted locations, because now I was an expert, because I did one for my neighbor. And so the bees that I started collecting, Wellington wouldn't let me keep them all. And so I had over 50 hives, sometimes 150, in my backyard in Wellington, and I decided I need to do something with the bees that I'm getting. And so I started a program through Bee Understanding of giving beehives away to beginner beekeepers to enhance that learning experience. And from what you've heard just from a couple panel members, I've affected a couple people. My organization gave over 700 hives away since the program started. And those hives, the people that I gave hives to have also split their hives and gave them to friends and got other people started in it. So thousands of hives have been created by the hives that were given away by Bee Understanding. So, okay, am I up?
Yeah.
All right, I'm up. So ask me any questions you want. We'll talk to you in a bit.
Hi, I'm Holly Shaw, and I'm very interested in plants and gardening and things of that sort. I'm a member of the Rare Fruit Council, and interested in conservation in nature. So I kind of started hearing about bees from my son, who was roped into helping his father catch bees and manage bees at his place. And heard about this place and heard about the FBBA program and came a couple of times, got interested, met Al and Sierra and got my first hive. It's about 3 years later. I am up to six hives. Really want to keep just four for my garden area. And so
she has two to give away.
And it's being worked on right now.
All right.
And so I'm in it mostly for the conservation and for the garden area I have. I'm hoping to set up a sort of a community garden with some friends in my backyard and eat local, grow local, and all that stuff. I'll have the bees, I'll have my trees, I'll have the plants, the vegetable garden, and extra bees will go back to FBBA so that other people can enjoy the same thing. I've only actually taken honey from my hives once because I let the bees keep it, so that's a little bit different that way.
Back down to Ruby. Oh, we missed Eric.
Yeah,
we missed
Eric. He wasn't there.
I was out trying to get dinner. So. Anyway, for those of you who don't know me, my name's Eric Baxter. I'm the apiary manager for the past 2 years and working on my third year. I first got into beekeeping. I went out to start a barbecue one time to throw some burgers on there, and I lifted it and went to go light it and saw about three or four paddles and a good cluster of bees in there. And I go, well, I guess I'm not using this one tonight. So I went over and lit the other one. For the next few months, my daughter and son and I watched it get bigger and bigger. And one night, I had a buddy over, and we went out and we lit the other barbecue. I went out there with a plate of hamburgers and set it on that grill. Not realizing, you know, I was dark and I wasn't thinking. And anyway, all of a sudden I felt, dink, dink, dink. And I'm like, that? And all of a sudden, one got me in the neck. Oh, that's what it is. So I took the hamburger off the grill, and the plate was cold, so I guess it was getting going. So anyway, then they settled down, and at that point, I decided, well, the grill isn't the best place for the bees. So I started calling around. And everywhere I called, I went in the Yellow Pages, and it's bee removal, and you know, everybody was pest control, and they said, oh, you gotta kill them. It's state law. And I go, you're not spraying chemicals in my grill where I eat my food. And number two, I don't want to kill the bees. You know, they're docile. They don't bother anybody. I just want to relocate them. So when that happened, I finally got a hold of Palm Beach County Beekeepers. And that's back when Uta was the president. And that was quite a while ago. Anyway, so she got me in contact with Leonard Kahn, which actually lives around the corner from me, and he came out and he vacuumed up the bees and relocated them for me. And then I started getting into the bees. I bought my first hive from him. And then a couple months later, he asked me to help him out on a removal that was up some scaffolding. So that got me started, and ever since then, I've been doing removals and getting into bees, and that's where I'm at. So, but like the most, one of the things that really bothered me was that, you know, the removal where they told you you had to kill the bees. It was state law. And that was just something that I thought was irresponsible. And if you actually read the laws, they want you to know what you're doing when you're removing the bees. They don't want you, you don't have to kill them. So that's what I got into, and that's where I'm at now. So and all I do is removals and keep bees. And now I'm starting to get to a point where I'm going to really try to make some honey this year. So we'll see how that goes.
How about money?
That I would have started 10 years earlier.
All right, thank you all. Before we open it up, Peter had an excellent suggestion to get a feel for the sort of the demographics of the crowd. By show of hands, who has bees now? All right.
Oh, good.
Okay. that's kind of, you know, who does not? Okay, well, that's a pretty good number, too.
Yeah, but who has them, but they're not keeping them? They're like... Oh, yeah. We're all being happy. I didn't know what to pay my hand for. They're like, yeah. Not mine, they're in my yard.
And who has hives for 5 years or more, just to get up? Okay, that's a very revealing vote. So with that, let's open it up for questions. You can either direct them to everyone and let anybody answer, or direct them to one of the panel members. So who wants to start it off first? Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Top entrances. Any input? I mean, I've been reading an awful lot, particularly with Bush, and I'm thinking about switching over to top entrances. But do we have any feedback?
Does anybody here run top entrance?
Here, I'll talk about top entrance. Then Sam can expand on it. So I typically run top entrances for when I'm first mounting a set of bees from a removal into a new hive box. Because when I put the queen inside that box, the bees are looking for her, and her pheromone is able to go up and out the top, and the bees find it quicker, they find where they're supposed to be quicker, and I let them get started with using that top entrance. But then after about 2 to 3 weeks, I switch them back to a bottom entrance. Bees will use any entrance on the hive.
We know that.
The box gets rotted somewhere and they start coming and going from wherever they want to go. I think the top entrance in the summertime has some advantages for helping them ventilate, but then can be a hindrance at certain times because they don't want that big of an entrance at the top because they can't control the ventilation inside the box. So inside the box, they are keeping different temperatures and different humidities within different sections of that box. Okay, so they like to bring air in from the top and have that air go down across the nectar to evaporate the nectar, or the water from the nectar. And then that moist, warm air then gets drawn down into the brood chamber to keep the young moist and warm. So so that's where I see the biggest advantage. But then, you know, it's during times when they have flow. So take it for what it is. I haven't seen that, hey, bees do, you know, this much better because they have a top entrance, because they can make it happen no matter where their entrance is. You know, I do removals continuously, and literally they will have a hole the size of a pencil going into an attic that's 200 degrees, and they're somehow able to draw in enough air to cool that space down to 95 degrees. And keep it at 95 degrees, even though the rest of the attic is at 120, 130 degrees. So they will make it happen. And I noticed that on some of my top entrances that they actually propolize them shut. And so it tells me that they don't, you know, want that much ventilation at the top. But they're propolizing it during certain time periods of the year. So it's like a screen bottom board. I see no difference between screen and unscreen. You know, they make it happen no matter what.
Bees, no matter what kind of hive or where your entrance is, bees tend to put their brood nest closest to their entrance. That's where they can ventilate it the best. And they tend to keep their honey furthest from the entrance. That's where they can guard it the best. So the only real drawback of a top entrance is that the bees will tend to chimney up their brood nest. And what I mean is that they'll tend to have their brood nest in the middle frames, going all up all the boxes and honey on the outside. So you might see a little bit more brood in the honey supers with an upper entrance. If you're in a cold climate like Michael Bush is, and he's a big advocate of top entrances, that entrance is really crucial to get moisture out through the winter. So that's one of the reasons he does it. Here in Florida, you can get away with putting your entrance just about anywhere. It doesn't make any difference to the bees.
None.
Okay. Next question. And when the question is whoever answers the question, please repeat the question with the microphone. So, So, next question. Go ahead, guys.
Feeding the bees. Right now, we should start feeding to get the broods built up for the next fall in March, April? Yes, no?
Okay, the question was feeding bees. If now is the time to do it, or if feeding bees before the actual flow for the nectar. It's good to start a couple weeks prior, or a good 3 weeks prior, so that you got a good brood cycle going before it goes into. But you have to be careful, because if you just throw a jar on there and think you're feeding bees, and then what happens is they have all this extra nectar, what they can do is they can start filling where the queen's supposed to start laying. And that could propose a problem. So you have to have, you got to kind of see if there's actually room for it, and how you do it is either a slow process, or you have to put extra frames in there where they have extra room to actually store it and go from there. But yeah, it's good to build them up. And you also got to look at the frames and see if they need feeding, because some of it is whether they need it or not. You know, if they have tons of honey storage and there's 2-3 frames of honey in there on each side, and then if you don't see any like nectar where it's not been capped, where it's wet, then if that's all dry, that means they're feeding on the honey. If it's wet and filled with nectar, it means they have some nectar coming in from somewhere. So feeding them isn't a necessity, but you know, it depends on what you're trying to do as far as building hives. If you're building and you're putting comb in, and you have drawn comb from other hives that's empty, you can take out a frame of honey and put that frame next to the brood, and the queen can lay in there and start building some nectar, and that the nectar flow will stimulate the egg laying.
When I was a backyard beekeeper and I just had, you know, 2 to 10 hives in my backyard, I never fed my bees. I always left enough honey in the beehives going into winter, and checked my bees periodically to make sure, like Eric said, that they do have nectar in the hives or honey. You don't want your bees to run out of food. Obviously, if your bees have no honey stores and or no nectar, you don't want starving bees. The responsible thing to do would be to feed your bees. But then it depends on what your goals are. If you want to bump up your bees to be ready for a honey flow because your goals are making honey, then start a regular feeding schedule for your bees, probably about 4 to 5 weeks before the honey flow, because an egg that the queen lays today when she's stimulated to start laying again won't hatch out for 3 weeks, 21 days, and then it takes a couple of weeks for those bees to be promoted to heavy duty foraging activities to go out and collect, be able to collect a lot of nectar. So about 4 to 5 weeks before your estimated nectar flow, if your goals are for making honey, is a good way to go for that.
My first year I fed the bees because I had so few of them. But I now have 7 colonies, and I have a deep super, on top of a deep super. Then I have a queen separator or excluder, and then my honey super on the top. I only harvest the honey from the honey super. Those two deeps have plenty of honey for the bees to survive the winter. So ever since then, I have never fed my bees either. So if you're going to be stealing from the, you know, I consider that to be the bees' honey for them. But if you're going to be stealing it from them, then you're going to need to feed. But if not, you can survive the winter without having to give them sugar water.
Okay, the point is, like right now, I'm trying to build up the hives to get splits. So I should feed.
Yes.
Depending on when you want to split. Like I have a projected date for the FBBA hive giveaway on April 1st. So about 6 weeks before that, I'll start a heavy duty feeding so that I can make enough splits to accommodate that. So it's dependent on the flow in your area. Like the area where I'm at now, there's very little nectar flow and such a huge concentration of commercial beekeepers that more feeding is required naturally for my area. But the bees that I keep at Broken Sound Club in Boca, for them, are making honey right now. So never have to feed those bees, but they're mature colonies. If you have nucs, you know, small nucleus colonies, those probably need to be fed throughout the winter. You know, I recommend that people don't start with bees in, you know, November, December, January, even February, because it's difficult to keep bees during that time if you're starting with a nucleus colony. A full-grown hive, a mature hive like Peter was talking about, they know how to be bees, they know how to do it, they've got the resources, you know, as long as they're healthy. But it depends on your area. The more east you are, the sooner the nectar flow begins, in my experience, is that, you know, the further south and the further east. Because the further east you are, like if when you get east of the turnpike, you have a much lower concentration of beehives per square mile, I guess. And so you probably don't have to feed in anticipation of a nectar flow, but it depends on your goals. So if you want to make honey, if you need to make honey for your living, if that's what your business is, or if you're a backyard beekeeper and that's your priority with your bees, start feeding about 6 weeks before. You know, it's February now, so yeah, I would start feeding now if your goal is to make honey.
Also depends on
expand the bee, get more hives.
Well, in our program, we feed the babies, the ones that are too small to have a good enough field force to get them going because we're making more bees all the time. And we support them till they're toddler size, maybe 5 frames. But then once they're about a teenager size, maybe 10 frames or bigger, they have to find jobs of their own.
Thank you.
So to round off part of that, you could feed bees whenever, as long as you give them space. So any time of the year, you can feed your bees. You can feed bees in the middle of June or in the middle of March when there's a big flow on, if your goal is to make bees. If you want to make bees and do splits, you know, feed them, but make sure they have room to build and you don't get them honey-bound, you know, with sugar water. Because honey-bound is worse than, you know, because your queen has no place to lay eggs. They're going to swarm on you, and instead of creating bees for yourself, you're going to be creating bees for me to remove. And I love you. Love you for that.
Right, I saw a hand going up in the room. The lady in the red, yes.
At Sierra's workshop, somebody had talked about rotating your hives in the spring. Can you say why and how?
So bees during these cold, so she said people talked about rotating your hives in the spring, and why would you do that, and what's sort of the idea behind that? So if you're running beehives, you know, mature beehives that are 2 to 3 boxes tall, like a lot of backyard beekeepers do to make it easy and healthy for the bees will naturally start to move up in those boxes, especially during the colder months. You know, heat rises, the bees start to move up, the queen is laying up here instead of down below. They'll start bringing in a lot of pollen, they'll fill the bottom box with pollen. So in the spring, you might go into your beehive, your top box, and say, oh, my bees are doing really well, there's lots of brood up here. If you were to explore further, which you know, during a regular inspection, you go into your beehive, you look at it, pull a frame, they've got room to grow, which, you know, this is my checklist. Do they have room to grow? Do you have evidence of a queen? Do they have food? Are they healthy? You know, once you see those on one frame, even, you might be done with your inspection during most times of the year. But in the springtime, if you venture further, you go into that bottom box, you'll see there's all dried up empty combs with a little bit of pollen in them. The bees stop using those combs down there because they've moved up. So if you rotate your boxes, you know, your bees are now in the bottom box, primarily the brood chamber, and now they have room to start growing up. So that's sort of the idea behind that. I like to go through, do a really good thorough inspection when it starts to warm up in the, you know, Florida spring. When does spring start? Like in March?
Thank you.
Like in February, middle of this month.
The end of February.
Middle to end of February. You start going through those boxes to rotate things around.
I've had people come up to me and say, oh, my hive is four boxes deep and it's just strong and it's just going. And I said, well, when's the last time you went into that bottom box or even the next, you know, the second box? Oh, I haven't gone that far in 2 years. It's like, you need to crack them boxes off of there and get down into those lower boxes to see what's going on. If you're not inspecting, there could be all kinds of weird stuff going on down there that you just don't know about. And it's really easy. You crack that box and set it on its end. Don't set it on its side.
Short side, always on the short side.
Yeah, and straight up and down. So your frames are going like this. The bees aren't really disturbed. And I recommend, if you're going to go do the inspection, just take that, you know, if you need to take the lid off, take it off. You don't have to. Crack that top box. Don't disturb it. Just crack that top box, set it, and work your way down to the bottom. That way you're not disturbing the bees. Because if you go down and you start at the top and you start going through, next thing you know, you're pushing all those bees down, and every box you got, they're loaded with bees. So what you do is you take that top box off and you take the second box off, and then you're at the bottom. Then you can do an inspection. If there's no bees in there, it's pretty easy.
Yeah.
You know, then you can do your rotation that way. And you go through the boxes across, all the bees run down. And then you think you got bees down in the next box, it's just the box the bees went down with you instead of you taking them off.
Smart, thank you.
Can you repeat again when you take the boxes off? You said something about
always on the short side. So your bee boxes have two short sides and two long sides.
Okay.
When you take the top box off, all the frames are going this way in the box, right?
Okay.
Along the long side. If you put it on its long side, the frames
are
going to
flop like this.
And if you have any foundationless frames, your combs are going to fall out, potentially. So if you put it on the short side, then your frames
You want to make sure your frames are up and down like this. When you take that box off and you set it on its end, the frames are going to be sitting like this, and they're not going to move. If you take it, you set it sideways, they can move.
Okay.
If the bees have propolized them in really well, they might not. But they can move and squish, and you might squish a queen.
Yeah.
You're gonna kill bees. So you always stack them on end, and you know, you take those if you're decided to go into that bottom box, you take them off one at a time and then get to the bottom box.
Why not?
Because dirt and grass.
Sticky, the propolis that's all around the frames, you stick it on the grass or on the dirt. You go to put it back on the hive and there'll be a rock stuck to the bottom of your box or twigs.
Then, you know, if you stick it on the ground and there's bees on the bottom frame, that grass and rocks is going to crush whatever bees are on the bottom of the frame.
Yeah, what if your queen walks out?
Yeah.
Short side with frames perpendicular to the ground. And, you know, when you work a top bar hive or a comfort hive, You always work your frames perpendicular to the ground. But I wanted to say, not just in the spring, check your bees for what's going on in that bottom box. I had a client last fall, right before the pepper flow, we went into that top box together. The bees did not look well. I was like, what's going on with these bees? Something's not right in here. We went into that bottom box, and sure enough, they had a lot of really nasty pollen in the bottom box that they'd propolized over, and the bees were sick. They'd gotten into something, they were having a hard time. We removed all of that yucky pollen and fed the bees a little bit to boost them up, and it cleared right up right away. But know what's going on in your hive, even in the bottom boxes.
Yes.
If bees take nectar from a poison plant, will the honey be poisoned?
Bees take nectar from a poison plant with
poison
honey.
Human.
Poison to humans. Was that rhododendron
yeah.
honey?
Yeah.
Is toxic, psychotropic,
yeah.
I guess. Azalea honey,
yeah.
also.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
There's an account of the invading Roman army, and a bunch of Greek beekeepers left out a bunch of rhododendron honey, I believe it was. And it just, it obliterated the army. It knocked them right out. The only toxic plant that I know of in Florida to bees is yellow jasmine. It's up in North Florida. And it'll look like a pesticide kill. It will kill the bees.
Will it kill the bees?
Yes, it will. There's death camas and a couple different plants.
What's
California buckeye?
Yeah, but we have the... you're the plant girl.
Yeah.
So what's the plant that...
There's oleander.
Oleander is the one that I'm thinking of. So oleander here in South Florida is toxic. You know, if they go to it,
but I've never seen
bees don't go to it.
Right.
You know, so
and
the same with
datura.
Datura is what they make digitalis from.
Yeah.
If you get too much of it, yeah, it's toxic to everything. I don't know though if it will kill your bees.
So yes, bees can go to poisonous plants and create poisonous honey. Sam was telling you about, it was an army somewhere in Europe, and they had a camp, and they left behind supplies in the camp, but they purposely left behind this azalea honey, so when the enemy raided the camp, they were gorging on this honey, and it gave them... yeah, they got the flow real easy.
But that only pertains to if the whole colony is consuming that plant source.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I'm sorry. In Colorado, where marijuana is legal, can they get an edible marijuana honey? I mean, not on purpose, but if you're just buying honey from Colorado...
I got this. Well, we have to say that bees are a gateway bug.
It's easier to get the gummy bears.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, just go for the gummies.
I think we should do it.
I don't think there's any nectar. It's a grass.
Oh, I got it.
Yeah,
pollen, maybe.
Sounds like a government study.
They said that they're actually working. You're 500 pounds.
The gummy bears work better.
Yeah.
What were they getting off it?
Panel's still out.
I got it.
I just had a question about what Peter said earlier about taking honey out of the sewer. We have a setup similar to yours, two sheets, an excluder, and the super. You can really take the honey out of the super anytime and not worry about the bees not having enough honey. Is that right?
But take it from the honey super.
If you take it from the super, yeah, but you still want to make sure your lower boxes still have honey in them.
Right.
Because they may have, like, the side walls are typically full of honey, but if they use that honey up and they got one or two frames up top and you take it, and then you're taking their supply. I mean, obviously, you want to make sure that the lower boxes have honey in there. You know, it's pretty much common sense. If there's no honey in the sides... You don't take what's up top, because they typically store up top and on the sides, so you just want to make sure that they're going to utilize what's around them, you know, and they're planning on using that if they're storing it, but they want to go for quick access when they need honey, so that they'll use the stuff on the side first.
They're insulator.
Yeah.
So two frames on the sides, and you can pretty much use what's in the.
Yeah, especially if it's a two deep or a three deep, you know, a single deep, maybe not so much.
Right.
Or you can steal it all and feed them sugar water.
Al, can you explain what happened with the colored honeys eating M&Ms?
Sure. Is that a good question?
Well, it's related to this, poison.
So Peter was asking about colors of honey. Honey will come in all different colors. You can get it from white to black and everything in between. Because of the plant that they're bringing nectar from. Each plant will create a different color and flavor of honey. Well, there's a couple instances where one in New Jersey where the beekeeper went in and his honey was blood red. Well, they found out that his bees were going to a maraschino cherry plant down the road.
Across the river.
Yeah, where they were storing 55-gallon drums of maraschino cherry juice without a lid on it, and the bees were taking it to, and they'll make honey out of anything that has sugar in it, you know, so. And then France, I believe it was, they were getting multicolored honey, and it was from an M&M plant. And the bees were actually going to broken M&Ms in the dumpster. And there have been instances where Publix would have frosting, colored frosting from the cake or bakery, and the bees would make honey out of it. I was called to a Dunkin' Donuts to do a bee removal, and it was right by my house. It was literally less than a quarter mile from my house. They had tens of thousands of bees at the back of the Dunkin' Donuts. Well, at 4 o'clock in the morning, they were making donuts, and they would glaze them and, you know, put them on the rolling rack, and the rolling rack would have glaze all over them. Well, after they were done, they would roll all the racks out back to hose them off. Well, as soon as the sun came up, my bees were over there saying, it's feeding time.
They didn't need to hose them off afterwards.
So they were like, can you remove these bees? I'm like, well, you're just going to have to change the way you do things. And they won't be here. But I didn't tell them that I lived right down the road.
I didn't charge them for the advice.
I've actually done a removal to where I've pulled out emerald green honey out of a wall of a house over here in West Palm. And it was an older style house, and it was right in the heart of West Palm. I don't know where
but
it
we're
came.
Still debating that one.
Yeah, we don't know if it's actually a plant or if it was a syrup or something from some candy or whatever. But that's the second time I pulled honey, not even from that house, but close to that location at two different times of the year, and I pulled out emerald green honey. When I saw it, I was like, wow, this is, you know, it tastes okay, but it's, you know, that's all I would do is taste it. I wouldn't drink it or eat it on a regular basis, but it was literally emerald green. I mean, everybody up here saw it, because I was asking. Yeah, they were. I was told maybe sea myrtle or something. I don't know. I don't remember the actual area, but it was like Broadway west of there, you know, yeah, this way of getting here.
And it was real close to St. Patrick's Day.
Yeah. Okay, next question.
Just to go back to what's the purpose of having a molten level hive? Because if we're talking about you have a soup on top for the honey, so why not when it comes to winter time? So why would people keep two dome and then, like you said, you have noticed that the bottom one and you have to rotate instead of just getting rid of it?
A lot of what happens is, okay, the question was, why do people keep their hives stacked up on top of each other when they can reduce it down? And the reason why, when you reduce the hive, what are you going to necessarily do with the comb? When it's sitting, the bees take care of it, they maintain it, they keep the wax moth off of it. If you got a freezer to put it in, yeah, you can take those boxes and shrink it down. I usually run a single deep for a hive. I don't do double deeps and triple deeps. You know, a lot of times, yeah, well, that's, you know, it's easier for me to move them. You know, I don't want to move three boxes of a hive. I don't want to move 200, 300 pound boxes. I like the 100 pounders or 80 pounds, you know, when I move them. But, you know, what happens is the bees tend to get more attitude when they're bigger as well. So, but it's more doing what you got to do with the comb when you take it off. The bees maintain it. You can take it down, you know.
So So in South Florida, we pretty much have continuous brooding. I don't think our bees really ever go broodless here. So every once in a while, I hear a commercial beekeeper say their bees are broodless. But it's very, very rare here. So you have constant brooding on one frame of, in a like a Langstroth hive, which is typically what people keep. One side of the frame is about 1,500 cells, okay? If you're in a flow and the queen is laying about 1,500 eggs in a day, she can lay up all 10 frames in 20 days. That's if she has no stores at all in the beehive, zero, right? Because, and usually, if you're a beekeeper, you know that the bees will make a rainbow of honey pretty much at the top of the frame. There might be some pollen in there, and then the brood will be in the center. Now, if your queen is laying all of those frames up, on the 21st day, she runs out of room to lay, and you can create swarming. Now, for commercial beekeepers, it might not be that big of a deal, because they're constantly rotating things around, they're changing things a lot. When you're a backyard beekeeper, so a commercial beekeeper is doing a lot of manipulations with the hive, and they run single deeps, queen excluder, box of honey on top. As a backyard beekeeper, if you do that, you're going to create a lot of swarming because you're probably not going to be making splits. You're probably not going to be taking a frame out here and there and giving them an extra comb for the queen to lay in. So it depends on what you're doing with your beehive. It depends on how much swarming you're willing to allow. How hands-on are you? You know, what are your goals as a beekeeper? If you take those boxes off, like Eric said, along with the year-round brooding that we have, also the small hive beetles and the wax moths have year-round brooding. So they will tear up your combs. If the comb has never had a brood cycle in it, it's virgin white comb, you can keep it off to the side and the wax moths or small hive beetles won't bother it. But if it has any papery cocoons from a brood cycle in it, if it's at all brown, you're going to get it torn apart by wax moths. You're going to lose it. So it depends. Now, a little tiny beehive doesn't have a lot of extra resources. So they don't have a lot of bees to allow for defending the hive. So that's what Eric was saying, that a larger hive can get crankier. A big hive, there's a little more unemployment, bees don't have a lot to do. Unemployment for bees is really bad.
They can get an attitude just because they can.
Yeah.
Yes.
They can afford to lose a couple of bees here or there, stinging you, whatever. They don't care.
So making sure that you have gentle bees is really important. Making sure they always have something to do is really important. So there are pros and cons to running it either way. It's more maintenance. So if you have a 10 frame hive and you're going to make a split, say a 3 frame split, and you take 3 frames out, now you have a little tiny 3 frame baby hive like Sam was talking about, you've got to feed it probably, unless you're in a really good nectar flow. So it depends. You know, it is timing. It's an art. But definitely if you want to make more bees and you've got several hives that you can do it from, you could be taking one frame out of 5 different hives to make a split.
So again, a lot of beekeeping, the first question you have to ask yourself is, what do I want to accomplish? Because if you want to accomplish lots and lots of honey, your goal is just to make as much honey as you can. You're going to run your bees like Eric runs them, one 10 frame box, queen excluder, and a super on top. And then once it starts getting too full of bees, you're going to split it. So then you have 2 beehives that are one box with a queen excluder and a super. And before you know it, you're going to have 100 beehives and you're going to be making a lot of honey because that's your goal. If you're a backyard beekeeper and your goal is, I want one beehive, I want to go in there and get enough honey for myself, I want to split one beehive, you know, give it to my friend every once in a while, you're better off running 2 10-frame deeps, then a super on top without even a queen excluder. Because the 2 10-frame boxes, by the time the queen lays the bottom box in eggs and goes up and starts laying eggs in the second deep, the bottom box is hatched out and she's going right back down to start laying eggs in the bottom box. And then once that one she goes back up to the second one. So you get this bouncing back and forth between the first and second box. And typically, she's not going up to lay in the super. If she is, hurrah, you have a great queen. And it's a center couple frames, you know, and you can work around it. And what that does, if you're a beginner beekeeper, if you're just starting beekeeping, I recommend you run two deeps in a super. Because it's going to take longer for them to swarm. If you're running one 10-frame deep, things going to swarm a lot quicker than if you have two 10-frames. And if you have one 10-frame box that has, let's say it has 20,000 bees in it, okay? And your queen goes to swarm and she takes, you know, 10,000 bees with her. You're down to 10,000 bees in that box.
She can take up to two-thirds.
Yeah, she could take 15,000 bees and you're left with 5,000. She left with three-quarters of that. Well, if you have two 10-frame deeps and you have 40,000 bees, and she leaves with 15,000 bees, you still have a lot more bees to recuperate from that swarming. And so your bees have a better chance of just regenerating themselves continuously without you having to do a lot of anything. And so, depending on what your goal is, set your goal of what you want to do. If you want to create bees, you're going to run bees in nuke boxes. Sierra and I want to create bees. And so we run everything in nuke boxes. A nuke box is 5 frames. Once those 5 frames are full, or just before they get 5 frames full, we put another nuke box on top. Once they fill up, you know, 4 frames of that second nuke box, we literally just take the top nuke box and split it in half. And now we have 2 nukes. Then 4 nukes, then 8 nukes, then 16, 32, 64, and I can't do the math after that.